All right. Do not be nervous, okay?
All right.
I sense a little fear.
Well, you know, I'm trying to act my way through it. Fake it till you make it.
All right. Weinstein.
But I answer to both, frankly.
You're not one of those people who say, correct?
I'm not a corrector, no. Yeah, nobody wins. Nobody really wins in that situation.
Albert Einstein. I guess Albert Einstein sounds better than Albert Einstein.
I did, in fact, when I added the Elvis, when I joined the Writers Guild, I considered J. Einstein Weinstein as a pronunciation guide to my last name.
Well, there's a Josh Weinstein.
I don't know what she is, but I've actually had lunch with him and I've met him a few times.
From The Simpsons.
Yes, he's the reason I'm J. Elvis. He beat me by like months into the guild.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
I worked with his brother.
Oh, really? Jacob?
Jacob Weinstein or Steen. He's a corrector.
Yeah, is he? Yeah, it's not cool. It's not cool, I got to say.
He really is. And it's like Caroline Ray is another person.
Yeah.
Who corrects you. Yeah, I guess.
Mel Brooks solved that with Young Frankenstein, Frankenstein, that whole mm-hmm. thing. You know.
Well,
once you see that, you have to stop correcting.
So, J. Elvis Weinstein, I got it right?
You did. You nailed it.
How'd you pick Elvis?
I picked an E because it made my initial spell Jew.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. And it was Elvis Costello, which I was pretty infatuated with at like 22, which is when I did it. So.
Okay. You're a Minnesota Jew.
I am a Minnesota Jew.
You're an Al Franken, Thomas Friedman from the New York Times.
Same suburb, St. Louis Park. Yes.
Yeah, they're a special type of Jew.
And the Coen brothers, too.
That's right. They're a special type of Jew. All of whom are great, except my rabbi. I had a rabbi from that area who turned out to be... okay, anyway... J. Elvis,
I had some rabbis from that area I didn't approve of fully myself. So.
And that's the great thing about being Jewish. You don't get molested by your rabbi because you're allowed to tell a rabbi to go F himself.
That's right.
It's not easy to be a Jew. It isn't. But built into the system is the guy who has a direct contact to God is full of crap, and you're taught that at an early age. He's just a teacher, and don't be infatuated with him, and you have every right to argue with him. Anyway, we're difficult people.
Perhaps even an obligation.
Oh, my God. Yes. Well, I don't want to do the talk about being Jewish.
Because I bet you've covered that on the show before.
And it's interesting. For years, I never talked about it. My father always said, your last name is Feldman. You don't need to talk about being Jewish. The audience doesn't care, and the Jews don't want to be identified with you.
Right.
So my stand-up act, I don't talk about being Jewish. But on the podcast, it comes up.
It's part of the flow of being a Jew.
Yes.
You talk about being a Jew at times.
Well, let me introduce you. J. Elvis Weinstein is the director of I Need You to Kill.
It's more emphatic.
Yes, I Need You to Kill. It's a documentary about comedy in Asia.
Yes. And which will be coming out via the company Comedy Dynamics very soon.
That's exciting.
It is.
Yes. I Need You to Kill. He was a writer, producer on Freaks and Geeks. He appears on my good friend Mark Thompson's podcast, The Edge.
That's right.
You also appeared on Mystery Science Theater. You dropped out of college to go work on Mystery Science Theater.
I did. I was one of the original guys on that, the original gumball machine guy.
With Frank Conniff. And here's how I learned that you broke your mother's heart, that you dropped out of the University of Minnesota to go work on Mystery Science Theater, here's how I found out. There's a new podcast that everybody will love. It's a part of the Showbriz family. It's produced by Showbriz Studios. Thought Spiral. It is hosted by J. Elvis Weinstein and Andy Kindler.
And Andy Kindler, more importantly.
I was going to say and Andy Kindler, but I figured I'd go Andy Kindler.
If he was like a 60s talk show sidekick, that's how they'd introduce him.
It's great. It's a great Thought Spiral. I listened to both test episodes. There are two test episodes available on iTunes. Thought Spiral.
By the way, the running gag is going to be they're all test episodes. I just blew the joke, but that's the title of every show.
I compare it. I don't smoke dope, but to me, it's like being high and listening to two friends talk. Where I'm so stoned, I can't move my lips. I'm just going to listen to my two buddies make nonsense.
That's pretty good, I guess. Uh-huh. That's pretty good. For the first two episodes, you know, I'd like it to get a little more formed, but not much. Because it's Andy.
It's Andy Kindler, who I call a bumblebee.
That's a pretty good image.
Because a bumblebee, they can't explain how a bumblebee flies. They actually asked.
Exactly.
And I don't understand how Andy Kindler is as... I mean, I love him.
No, I've actually described him, his show, his act as greater than the sum of its parts.
Andy should not fly. Not only does he do references that only I get.
Sure.
Well, at least that's the trick. He's like Mary Tyler Moore. You know, every guy thought they were the only one who thought Mary Tyler Moore was sexy.
Well, that was the trick to Mystery Science Theater, too, is everyone thought that reference, how only us, me and that robot puppet know that reference.
Right. And Mary Tyler Moore took place in Minneapolis.
Also, yes, full circle. There you go.
But Andy takes it a further step by biting every hand that can feed him.
Yes.
Like Rickles.
And if he's feeding himself, he'll bite his own hand.
How did you meet Andy Kindler?
You know, we honestly can't remember, but we have so many common friends. It's, you know, it's 20 plus years ago now that it happened.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it was probably at maybe Chris Bliss's house or just one of our common friends' houses, I think.
And is Andy a social animal?
Andy is not. His nature isn't to be a social animal. I think he's a hermit who, when forced into a social situation, becomes a social animal.
And how do you force him into a social situation?
You schedule a set for him.
It's kind of like me.
Yeah, I think it's like most comics. I don't think most comics are social animals for the most part.
Why is that?
Well, because I think we always feel like the other person isn't going to be interesting enough for us.
Ooh.
Was that too honest?
Because it's either I'm not going to be interesting enough for them, or they won't be interesting enough for me. But that's kind of interesting that you would lead off with that. I'm always like reluctant to go to parties.
Yeah, well, I have big social anxiety myself.
Me too.
And cocktail parties are the absolute worst situation for me, because it's all small talk and you never get to a real conversation, and something about that like makes my nervous system go into overdrive.
Are there any parties where you're relaxed?
If it's a small part, like dinner parties are great. If it's a table full of people I basically know already, then I'm very happy, you know. But if it's a room full of strangers, I would much rather be in front of them with a mic than among them with a drink.
Do you mind if I repeat a story that you haven't heard but my listeners have?
Sure.
Okay. Before Passover.
Especially if it goes that direction instead of the other one.
Okay. Before Passover, I was hanging out with Gilbert Gottfried, right?
Uh-huh.
And he was, and by the way, this story goes nowhere. It's just insight into who I am So Gilbert and I are sitting there with his amazing wife. They were talking about trying to get John Davidson on the show. Do you remember John Davidson? The singer,
sure.
Good-looking guy, son of a preacher man, actually was the son of a preacher man. And Gilbert's...
I remember him mostly from That's Incredible and from his daytime talk show.
Right. Very pure and innocent.
Yes.
So Gilbert was saying he was having trouble booking John Davidson for Gilbert's amazing podcast. I said, why don't you call him up and say, I'll only ask you about the Beverly Hills Supper Club. You're too young to laugh at that, of course.
I am. I'm sorry.
And, and let me assure you that what I said was absolutely horrid. It was horrible, terrible, disgusting, evil. And Gilbert loses it. He loses it. And he's like, and you know, for me to, you know, have Gilbert losing it over something I said.
There you go.
And his beautiful wife didn't get it because she's innocent and beautiful and young. And we explained it to her. And then, of course, she loses it and Gilbert loses it. And Gilbert goes off to a Seder. I don't want to. He has a magical show business Seder.
Okay.
So I have to go to my Seder. And I'm driving with my sister and some other people. I said, I have to go to a Seder now and behave. And I can't talk about the Beverly Hills Supper Club fire with anybody. And Gilbert gets to sit with 20 people and do Beverly Hills Supper Club references, and I just have to smile and answer questions. And that's what happened. I had to go, for, you know, the Jewish Inquisition.
Right.
What are you doing?
A giant letdown.
How's your marriage? Why'd you get a divorce? That kind of thing.
Yeah.
So are we only comfortable around Gilbert Gottfried?
I think it's other comics. I think
no, specifically Gilbert Gottfried, though.
Well, you know, I don't. If I hear that Gilbert's now comfortable with himself, which is a whole different dynamic than I remember meeting Gilbert Gottfried.
I just started hanging out with Gilbert seriously, and I would just gravitate to him whenever there was a party, like Fugelsang would have a party or something at the Friars Club. He didn't really know me, and I would just glom on to him.
I think that's smart.
Yeah.
Smart move.
So, social anxiety.
Yeah.
I heard a rumor that you live next door to Andy.
Not next door, but with like a few blocks.
And he comes by in the middle of the afternoon to borrow a cup of obscure references, right?
Absolutely.
So do you hang with him?
Well, as much as he'll hang, you know, it's now I hang with him once a week, which is part of my devious plot.
Mm-hmm.
But since he moved in like a couple of years ago, and we only saw each other slightly more than when he lived across town. But I also started going, we really need to do something together. We live too close to not.
So. Now, his temper, this is one of the things people don't realize. The police are always coming out to his house, right?
Absolutely. He's reporting himself for domestic self-abuse.
And he's always fighting with the neighbors. The tree is too big. The figs are falling into my backyard. It's clogging my gutters, right? Isn't he?
Yeah, I think he would probably blame his gutters first and then probably rebel against that, you know?
So where do you see Thought Spiral going? Do you see live shows? Do you see getting more political?
We're kind of veering away from the political right
good.
Now, just because it's too much choir preaching.
Mm-hmm.
And there's better people doing that right now who've established a format to their show and things like that. So,
but Andy's very political.
Andy's very political, and so am I. But it's just it's an off ramp from fun a lot of the time.
Uh-huh.
So for now, it's more just it's you know how like when you've had him as a guest many times, I'm sure, and I know you had him recently. So and the trick when you have him as a guest, which I've done on my other show too, is you let him go. So the trick on this show for me is to run alongside him and not let him go, you know, and try, you know, and try to keep up and try to, you know, go, oh, we got a, there's a cliff coming up. Let's go right. But otherwise, you know, it's pure Andy.
Uh-huh. And what have you discovered about doing your own podcast that you didn't know before? For example, how hard was the license to get? The test was pretty tough, right? For the podcasting license?
It was really, yeah, it was hard. It was hard. But I studied. See, I'm in yes and mode just from working with Andy. I'm always yes and. It's yes Andy is what we should have called it.
Yeah. I would say Jews are not good at improv because of the yes and.
Exactly.
No, if it were no but, we'd be okay.
No, you're wrong.
Why don't you and Andy try to do that as an episode? The no but improv. Where you just deny every premise. What can we look forward to on Thought Spiral?
Every Monday we'll be coming out. We got a new one coming out Monday, test show number 3. And I think, you know, you can look forward to us just getting better. You know, I can't really promise anything other than, you know, we've got 60 plus years of showbiz under our belt in this show, so we're going to want to steer towards better.
I don't know if you need to be better. I think...
Well, that's very nice.
I think it's authenticity, truth, and honesty, and it's already there.
Well, thank you. That's what I want mostly, but, you know, I also want less of... What was I just saying? You know, that's not a great moment.
I think when people listen to podcasts, they just want a human being. They want an interesting human being who is just giving them the truth. I have a theory about certain types of podcasts and why I think your podcast is going to be great. You want to know why?
I definitely do.
Okay. Most people are isolated, including me. Most right. people are desperately alone, like me. Most people are starving for human contact, intellectual stimulation, and friends. We're a very lonely people, the Americans. We're very lonely. When you listen to two close friends talking, it's reminiscent of our childhood. It's reminiscent of our older brother talking to his cool friend. And, you know, I'll keep my mouth shut. Let me just come into your room. I won't say anything. All right. And that's what a podcast is. That's what your podcast is. It's the two cool older brothers who are letting you in to the bedroom so you can just hear them talk about stuff. And
wow. We will never get a nicer description than that. Thank you.
Really?
Yeah, I love that.
And that's all a podcast has to be.
Yeah, I kind of agree. It's a vibe.
It's a vibe. I'm being serious. I don't have that. So I have to work a lot harder. I'm serious. I'm not cool and I'm not endearing. You guys just have this cool banter. You're friends. It's a great car. It's a great car ride. That's what people are looking for in a podcast. It's also a medium in and of itself. When I started, I was thinking, okay, well, this is an extension of my radio show. No, it's different. It's
personal.
And it is what it is.
Right.
It's a podcast. Don't try to make it anything other than what it is. I'm not giving you advice, by the way. I'm just giving myself.
I'll take it as advice, but I also will take it as affirmation that I kind of agree. I don't believe that a podcast is just a radio show with different distribution. I think it's a different animal.
Uh-huh. And again, I'm haunted by my appearance on Marc Maron. I was, I think, his third guest.
Yeah.
I was very condescending to him because I had been doing a podcast for maybe 3 months longer than he was, so I was just giving him advice. So, and then, of course, I sound ridiculous because I'm eating his dust.
I remember when I was doing stand-up as a, I started when I was a teenager, and there was a, I'd go on the road with these guys who were just the most grizzled old veterans, and you go, well, how long have you been doing? And they'd be like, 4 years.
Right. Like, oh, right. It, at the beginning, I'm still locked into that. When I see Will Durst or Bobby Slayton,
right.
But when I was starting it, they had been doing it maybe 4 years longer than I had. They were seniors, and I was.
Yeah, Durst was one of my early grizzled veterans.
Yeah, and now we're peers. It changes.
Right.
I'll tell you the advice that I'm giving myself. Okay, because I don't want to sound ridiculous. Because a man in my position cannot afford to sound ridiculous. Jack Waltz, Godfather. My advice to myself is what I told my son and my daughters at their bat and bart, whatever, their mitzvahs.
Right.
Stay exactly the way you are right now. You're perfect.
Oh, thank you.
Don't change.
Well, it's Kindler. How much can change, really?
I make mistakes on this show when I change, when I forget what this show is, or I get ahead of my skis, as they say.
Right.
Just be yourself. Don't change.
I will take that advice to heart.
Alex Brazell, who is your producer, you're with Showbriz Studios, right?
Sure.
We have this saying, back to zero. We always go, it's time to reset, back to zero. What got us here? And that's, so remember your first couple of episodes, because you're going to stray from that, and it may be a mistake. I'm not giving advice. I don't want to sound patronizing.
Yeah, I honestly don't. I can't see us straying too far from what it is, because I can't ever see any infrastructure developing.
Mm-hmm.
It's always going to be Andy coming over at 9 o'clock Monday night and us sitting down and him leaving a little after 10.
That's heaven. That's why I listen. The thought of being, you know, I'm in New York. I miss L.A. And the thought of hearing you two talk, it's, you know, I wish it were in smell-o-vision.
Yes.
So I could get the pheromones, the comedy pheromones that are... Are you married?
I am. My wife goes to bed when Andy comes over.
By the way, Andy has almost as annoying a laugh as I do. Almost as annoying.
He has his showy laugh, mm-hmm, and his silent laugh.
Yeah, he's got that staccato teletype laugh that I love, that I kind of have. And it's just saying, I think that's funny. I think that's funny. I think that's funny. I think that's funny. Hey, yeah, so if you're in a relationship, my advice is, and this is, I'll give you advice from a failed marriage.
When you said I'm going to give you advice, I was thinking the last time I saw you in person when you were in town for your divorce proceedings.
The best way to maintain a relationship is remember what got you into that relationship.
Working for Greg Kinnear.
Is that how you met?
Yeah, she was. I was a writer on his talk show, and she was his assistant.
Talk Soup?
I worked on Talk Soup, but this was later on NBC.
I love Talk Soup. Oh, his late night show after Conan, right?
Yeah, I was the head writer in the second year, but I was a staff writer the first year.
Yeah, you know, he's somebody you should never underestimate. You underestimate Greg Kinnear at your own peril. That guy, when he was in Sabrina, by the way, he was great in the remake of Sabrina. And I remember thinking, all right, come on, really? Greg Kinnear's going to be an actor? He's a great actor.
Yeah, but he grew into it. I was working for him when he did Sabrina. And, you know, I knew all those moves that he used in that movie. But he since grew into being a genuinely good actor.
And autofocus.
Yeah.
How that's great
Bob,
a movie.
That's the Bob Crane one, right?
Have you seen that?
I did, yeah.
Do you remember autofocus?
Yeah, it was sort of like the banality of sexuality.
It's one of the great movies. It is the one of the great Hollywood movies. What's the Ben Affleck movie about George Reeves, Superman?
I don't know.
That's I've never seen. A great double feature. Is
yeah, similar stories, similar yeah. kind of dark, same darkness, different eras.
I think he was so overlooked for autofocus. If you want a great depressing movie, rent Autofocus. It's the story of Bob Crane from Hogan's Heroes, who was an innocent and became very successful, got caught up in the world of early porn.
A video pioneer.
Thought Spiral every Monday on iTunes. J. Elvis Weinstein, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. It was fun.
All right, now we're doing the post. What we do on my show is a wrap-up after the interview where I tell you what you did right and what you did wrong.
Okay, good.
I'm kidding. We don't do
that. I'm still in yes and mode.
Oh, okay. Stay on the line. We're going to stop, but stay on the line for a second, okay?